We're so glad that you've joined us today for the premier episode of Biblically Grounded from Affirm Apologetics. On this program, we're going to be talking about biblical archaeology. We're going to be talking about finds. We'll talk about the historicity of the Bible. We'll talk about things like the inerrancy of Scripture. And every week we'll have a guest who is an expert in their field, someone who has done the work, who has done the research. And for our premiere initial episode, I'm very excited to have on here my friend, Bryan Windle, from BibleArchaeologyReport.com. Bryan, welcome to the program.
Clayton, thank you so much for having me. I'm just honored that you would invite me on and for the premiere episode. That's exciting.
Well, you know, I mean, you're someone I've always enjoyed listening to. I've seen you on other programs, and you do some very interesting things, and you're good at describing things for the layperson. You're good at putting things in a way that we can understand easily. And so when I finally got to meet you and work with you in person, we dug together for two seasons at Shiloh. Lord willing, we'll get some more opportunities for that.
Absolutely, Lord willing. What's the saying? Next year in Jerusalem. So
that's
Lord
right.
Willing.
That's right, Lord willing. And so not only Bryan, but his wonderful wife, Jen, they are a beautiful couple. They have been good to me. They actually, Bryan, I've got to thank you. I wanted to wait till we were actually recording to thank you for the wedding gift. We put that to
You're most use. Welcome.
So it's good. So just so our listeners and our friends know, Bryan is from the Great White North. And probably one of the coolest wedding gifts we got at our wedding this summer was the maple syrup from Bryan. It was amazing.
From good old St. Joseph Island, Ontario, Canada. You betcha.
And so, okay, so you're on St. Joseph Island.
I am,
You're up there. You are a pastor, Bryan. Tell us about your church and your ministry.
Yeah, so I live in rural northern Ontario, and so like the town that I live in, I think has a population of 400, maybe. So small town, rural, northern Ontario. And our church is a Bible chapel, and I'm the pastor, although I also do a lot of work with youth ministry there too. And little church of about 100 people, and just really honored. A friend of mine who was a pastor just passed away recently, and he said at his funeral there was something said that he could never get over the privilege it was to serve the Lord as a pastor, and that has stuck with me since then. And on the hard days I try to remember that, and on the good days I try and celebrate it. So yeah,
that is great. You know what's really interesting? I'm seeing a trend right now. And maybe it's just because of the company I keep, but I'm seeing this trend of pastors becoming archaeologists. a friend of ours, Brent Hofling, just graduated with his master's degree in biblical history and archaeology, and he's, of course, is a pastor in Texarkana. Why, Bryan, why are pastors becoming archaeologists?
Well, I think a lot of us as pastors probably have an interest in the history that's behind it. And when I first wanted to get into this and started my master's degree, when I talked to the elders at our church about it, I said, you know, I'm not looking to go anywhere. Generally people don't make a living as an archaeologist. They have a day job somewhere else. And so I'm not looking to go anywhere, but I think it'll make me a better pastor. I think it will help me understand the historical background of the text. It illuminates the text, which will then make me a better Bible teacher, I hope. And so I think that's, at least that's for me, that's why I got into this and I'm pursuing a master's degree. And I've made no bones about the fact that I would love to add archaeologist to my job title at some point, pastor archaeologist. And, you know, we have a good friend who 30 years ago went down this road. Gary Byers was a pastor and an archaeologist. And so it's great to provide and to do good scholarship and good research And then to do that with a pastor's heart for people and communicating that is a good thing, I think.
Well, good. And Bryan, the work you do, bringing these things on BibleArchaeologyReport.com, you have on that site, you have things like top 10 lists, top three lists, just of different biblical artifacts. You talk about biblical people. You interview archaeologists. Tell us a little bit about that ministry.
Well, it was really a spin-off of my work at ABR. And so I'm a staff researcher and writer with the Association for Biblical Research. And I had done a couple of blogs just before I got connected with them about archaeology, but my blog was more general in nature. And what I found was that people really were quite interested in the historical side of things, the archaeology. And so I started doing work with ABR, and I talked to ABR, and I just said, "Hey, I'm not going anywhere, but I'm doing this little blog on the side where my goal is to take the technical stuff of archaeology and try and communicate it in a way that the average, I joke sometimes, that the average millennial can understand." And so that's what I'm trying to do. Most of my blogs, I try and keep them so you can read them in 5 to 10 minutes max. And ABR does that too, although they also have the more technical side of things as well, obviously, because they're leading a dig at Shiloh. So my blog is geared specifically to trying to, I almost view myself as a translator, trying to translate things for the average person, trying to distill the research down into bite-sized nuggets so people can capture the main points of important places or people or artifacts related to the Bible.
Great, and I agree with your passion there. I tend to think of myself also as a translator, as someone who can take the technical publications, who can take all the big jargon and archaeology talk, and turn it into something that the people in the church can understand, something that is right there for everyone. And I think if, like you said, you put it on your millennial level, and my thoughts are, if we write things at, say, a high school level, that puts us in a nice place, that gets us out there to where people can read about the Bible, they can understand the historicity of the Bible, and they can share it with others. And so I love that part of your ministry. So definitely something to check out. Your Bible Archaeology Report is one of my favorite resources. I use it for
Thank
when
you.
I'm writing.
Well, and I do. I'm getting older now, so sometimes I'm like, "Oh, I know I wrote something about that. Hang on," and I'll go search, and I'm like, "Oh yeah, okay, there we go. That's how I." So it's a great resource for myself too as I get older.
Yes, that happens. I go back to my seminary papers. I'm like, I've got that here somewhere. Where's that research? Yeah, no, that's great. So, Bryan, we're going to talk a little more about you and our relationship at Shiloh in our next episode. We're going to do two episodes here, but what we want to talk about are the top 10 archaeological finds of the Old Testament. And we're going to cover five in this episode and five in the next, time allowing. We'll see how we get
Sounds
this
good.
done. So let's just go ahead and start. Let's get into that. So you've put together these lists, and this one is top 10 archaeological finds of the Old Testament. How does an artifact or a find end up on your list?
Well, it's well, first of all, I started out, I wanted to do a top 10 related to the Bible. And what I found was that there just were simply too many significant discoveries to just choose 10. So I split it into a top 10 for the Old Testament and a top 10 for the New Testament. So how does one get on the list? Well, so I have a couple of criteria. One is that I want it to be directly related to the people, the places, or the events in the Bible. So for example, if you have the ESV Archaeology Study Bible, great resource. There's an article at the beginning in which they go through, I think they do a top 10 of the Bible, top 10 discoveries related to the Bible. And their number one choice for the number one discovery of all time is the Rosetta Stone. Now, the Rosetta Stone is a hugely important discovery. It was a monument that was discovered by Napoleon's army in 1799, and it was the key to finally being able to decipher Egyptian hieroglyphics. And so that's an important discovery, but it's not directly related to people, places, or events in the Bible. So I'm not including things like that, as important as they are. Or I also would include things that are directly related to the composition of the Bible. And so sometimes hugely important manuscripts would make my lists. And so those are the two things that we look at. And then really, you could probably do a top 100 list. There are just so many, but I try and choose the big ones. And I will say that I try to choose the ones that have the most unanimity on. So what I mean by that is I, for example, on my New Testament list, I don't have the Shroud of Turin, for example. Now, I have my own feelings about what that is, but that's a highly controversial one, and there are arguments for and against. And so most of the ones that people will see on my list are ones that it doesn't matter whether you're Christian or atheist, archaeologists generally will agree with this. There are some fringe, of course, who don't, but generally they enjoy broad consensus in the archaeological community.
Yeah, yes. Okay, so we've got our parameters here. We understand what we're looking at. And I actually have the study Bible sitting here. It's a newer edition. So I just thought, oh, should I start going through and looking for that and find their top 10 list?
Yeah,
do that later. So let's go ahead and look at your top 10 list. And the number 10 item on this list, can you tell us, it's a collection of items, correct?
Yeah, and it's unique to my list in the sense that I've seen other top 10 lists and nobody really includes this on it in this particular way. And it's Assyrian inscriptions, and I have that a general term, but I want to look at it kind of in two ways. The first thing is this, in the Old Testament, we aren't given absolute dates like we think of them. We think of, you know, it's the year 2024, or we use, BC, AD, or the, if you're in academia now, the more modern BCE and CE. So we use those terms, but those are absolute dates. In the Old Testament, they used relative dating. And so when you read, for example, through the book of Kings, you'll see that, one king came to the throne in the second year of another king from either the northern kingdom or southern kingdom or vice versa. But we are able to now date things absolutely because of the Assyrian inscriptions primarily. So there are these things called the Assyrian Lemu lists. They had a practice, the Assyrians did, of naming every year after a person. And that person was named the Lemu for that particular year, usually a high official of the court or a governor or maybe even the king himself. And historical events were then assigned to that year, the major historical events. So they would give the Lemu name and the major events. And so, and these are consecutive year after year after year, but they didn't have anything to date them absolutely until they discovered that one of the years, in one of them, it named an eclipse of the sun that took place. Well, now we can go back and pinpoint that exact date. And scholars have pinpointed that date was June 15th, 763 BC. And so as soon as you get the absolute date for that one, you have the absolute dates for all the ones that precede it and come after it. And so essentially, with that one detail, they were able to come up with 250 years of mostly consecutive Assyrian history. Now, that's helpful on that side. And then we look at the Assyrian annals, the annals of the Assyrian kings, because still, in order to get things in biblical chronology, we need to see where there was overlap or interaction between Assyrian kings and biblical kings, the kings of the Hebrew kings of Israel and Judah. And we know from scripture that there were multiple times when that happened. A major one, for example, is in 701 BC when Sennacherib attacks and invades Judah. And so if you look at the Lemu list for that year that was for 701, it notes that Sennacherib is in the area of Judah, southern Levant. When the guy who published this first, Smith, he listed it as Palestine, although that carries different connotations now. You know, they would, the Assyrians would use the term like Hatti land is kind of the term that they used, or Hattu, for that region. And so now we've got, oh, we've got a connection there. We have a couple of others that were made as well. So, for example, on the Kirk monolith of Shalmaneser III, it lists King Ahab as one of the kings in a Western coalition that fought against Shalmaneser III at the Battle of Kakar. Now, that's not an event that's listed in Scripture, but we know from history, we can date that event to 853 BC, and that's helpful because that gives us when Ahab lived, and another one, the Black Ublis, a very famous one of Shalmaneser III, which has King Jehu on it, that dates right to 741 BC. So we have all of these interactions between the Hebrew kings and the Assyrian kings, and because we have the Lemu lists, we're now able to establish a chronology, an absolute chronology, for much of the Old Testament. I should mention one other thing. Many people have looked at the dates that are in the kings, and they've tried to add them up, and none of this works. It doesn't really add up. Edwin Tille was really, I think, the person who cracked the code by realizing that some kings used different dating systems, whether they used the first year was a full year, and so or whether year one started the day they took the throne. And so all of those things went into it, and some of them had New Year's in the spring, some had the fall. And as soon as you put all of this together, you now had a chronology for the Old Testament, and it goes back to these Assyrian Lemu lists and the Assyrian annals of the kings, and so hugely important.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And Tilly's book, What the Mysterious Numbers of the Hebrew Kings, is a great resource. So we're talking about the Assyrians here. Who are the Assyrians? How do they relate to the Bible? We've mentioned King Ahab, King Jehu, some of these kings of Israel and Judah. Who were the Assyrians? How did they interact with the Hebrew people?
Yeah, so the Assyrian Empire, many scholars would say that the Assyrians were the first world empire, the first true world empire in terms of conquering much of the world. And there are, I believe, six Assyrian kings that are named in the Bible. I have archaeological biographies on all of them. Last month, I finished the final king of the Assyrian ones that are listed there. And so they live off to the east in Mesopotamia. There were a series of empires, and so the Assyrians came first, and then the Babylonians, and then the Persians, and then the Greeks, but the Assyrians were kind of the first big ones. And truly, some people would say Neo-Assyrian, because the Assyrians themselves had been around probably 1,000 years before that, but they became the world empire largely during the 9th century BC was a huge time for them. And the 8th century BC as well. Probably one of the big ones we see quite often in Scripture is Tiglath-Pileser III. He's one of the early kings, a very hugely important king who's mentioned numerous times, both by that name and his other name, Pul. They often had several different names. And so just a hugely important people off to the east who conquered much of the world, including the Assyrians later on. Conquered even Egypt at the time and made Egypt vassals. So there's this whole, they call it the Fertile Crescent, that goes around from Mesopotamia up through Syria and down through the areas of Israel and Judah and into Egypt. And the Assyrians conquered all of that area and beyond, even to the east.
Yeah. Bad guys, probably most famous in Sunday school when we have Jonah going to to minister to bring a prophecy to them. Yeah, wow. So, So what is our number nine artifact then?
Well, our number nine artifact relates to the Persian Empire. We've just gone through the empires, so the later Persian Empire after the Babylonians, and it is the Cyrus Cylinder. So King Cyrus the Great is mentioned some 20 times in the Bible, and the prophet Daniel, for example, was still alive and in Babylon when Cyrus conquered the city. We know that from Daniel 5:31. And the Nabonidus Chronicle is it's like a poem about the last king of Babylon, actually co-regent of Babylon, because his son Belshazzar also reigned with him. But it's not a flattering. It's written to kind of make him look bad and make Cyrus look really good. But it talks about how Cyrus took the city of Babylon, and he entered it, and the people celebrated. He took it without a fight, and Herodotus gives more details, the historian, about how they did that. And so Cyrus comes in. Well, he conquers the area. The Babylonian policy had been to capture people and bring them to their region. And so we have this all of these exiles. Of people who study the Bible will know that the people of Judah were taken into exile. Prophets like Daniel and Ezekiel taken into exile, some of the Hebrew kings taken into exile. And so when Persia took over, they had this decision to make, what do we do with all these exiles? And it appears that Cyrus instituted a new policy by which he allowed the captured peoples to return homes. And in order to curry favor with the gods, because he was a polytheist, he sent all of the gods, all of the captured idols home with the people so that they could rebuild the sanctuaries and people could rebuild their homes. And that was the policy. Now, some people have suggested, because before we found the Cyrus cylinder, really the only thing we had to really testify to this was the Bible. That was the strongest voice saying the Israelites were, or the people from Judah were allowed to return back to Jerusalem and rebuild the city and the temple. And this was a decree of Cyrus. And some people maybe said, well, yeah, but a king wouldn't let all the conquered people go home. That doesn't make any sense. But then we find the Cyrus cylinder. It was discovered in 1879 in the ruins of Babylon. And it's a baked clay cylinder. It measures about 22 centimeters by 10 centimeters. So it's like quite a small little cylinder is what it is. And it's inscribed in the cuneiform script in the Akkadian language. And this is what it says. It says, I am Cyrus, the king of the world, great king, the mighty king, the king of Babylon, the king of Sumer, the king of Akkad, the king of the four quarters, blah, 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 the great king. And he describes how, he says this, from Babylon, as far as the region of Gittim, the sacred centers on the other side of the Tigris, whose sanctuaries had been abandoned for a long time, I returned the images of the gods who had resided there to their place, and I let them dwell in eternal abodes. I gathered all their inhabitants and returned them to the dwellings. May all the gods whom I settled in their sacred centers ask daily Bel and Nabu, two of the Babylonian gods, that my days be long, and may they intercede for my welfare. And so he's letting all of the people go home. Now, with the Jewish people, they didn't have idols. They didn't have idols that represented their gods. And so the specific decree for the Jewish people is recorded in the book of Ezra. In Ezra, we read these words, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, because he had made a prophecy about this. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that he made a proclamation throughout all of his kingdom and put it in writing. Thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth and has charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Whoever is among all of his people, may his God be with him, and let him go to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and rebuild the house of the Lord, the God of Israel. He is the God who is in Jerusalem. And so we have the specific decree issued for the Jewish people. And we don't have that left historically outside of the Bible, but we do have the Cyrus cylinder, which aligns beautifully with what we read in scripture to see that this was indeed the public policy of Cyrus the Great of Persia when the Persians took over from the Babylonians.
It is great to see something like that. When you read in the Bible about a person, and then you find something in the ground that shows that that personality that you've read about and the ideas that that person had, sure enough, you know, that's what we find historically. It's an amazing thing. So, Bryan, We've talked a bit about the Assyrians, the Persians. Let's move into someone a little more familiar to most of our listeners, and that, of course, would be the Egyptians. Because item number three, it's another inscription, the Merneptah stele. Can you tell us what, because that's a weird word. What is, those are two weird words. What is the Merneptah stele?
All right. So a stele or a stela, this is a victory monument. And kings of all different backgrounds in the Near East would erect these in their honor when they conquered something, or often at the end of their life, they would, you know, display all of their deeds on one of these victory monuments. And Merneptah is the name of a pharaoh. Now, he's not maybe one of the more famous pharaohs. I mean, when we think of pharaohs, we often think of Thutmose III or Ramses the Great. Those are probably the two that come to people's minds first. But Merneptah was a hugely important pharaoh because of this stela. And so here it is. In 1896, Sir Flinders Petrie discovered that it's 10 foot tall. It's a 10 foot tall victory monument, and it's intact. Which is amazing. Oftentimes, in archaeology, we find pieces of victory monuments, but this one is intact, and it records the victories of the Egyptian pharaoh Merneptah. Merneptah reigned. The Egyptian chronology is not the most exact, but probably from about 1213 to 1203, and it's an account of his victories over the Libyans. But at the bottom, right near the end, is a second campaign that he talks about, that he went into Canaan. Probably sometime around 1208 BC, and he says this on it. It contains a number of cities, and then it contains this claim that Israel is wasted, its seed is not, and Canaan is become a widow because of Egypt. Now, dating-wise, according to biblical chronology, the one that I would hold, I would place this in the period of the Judges. So if we want to think of events that are happening in the Bible. This is the period of the Judges, and we don't know anything in the Bible from this particular campaign, but what's really interesting is that Israel is listed along with other cities in Canaan, like Ashkelon and Gezer, but Israel is the only one that is followed by the hieroglyphic symbol that denotes a people group rather than a political entity. So it's not a city, it's a people group that is there. And so this indicates that Egypt viewed Israel as a powerful political group in Canaan at the time, but not a city. And so that's important to understand. And secondly, I would argue, and not just this isn't unique to me, many scholars have argued this before me, that because of the parallel with Israel being defeated, so Canaan is no more, it implies that Israel is the most powerful group that is in Canaan at this particular time in the Judges, which period comes right after the conquest. That would fit biblically as well. And it's important for a number of reasons. First of all, it is the oldest definitive reference to Israel outside of the Bible. Now, the key word there is definitive, because there are two that are older. There is the Soleb inscription, which talks about the Shasu or the nomads of Yahweh, which I believe, and many scholars believe, is Israel, but doesn't say Israel, so it's not a definitive one. There's another one called the Berlin Pedestal, but the name ring is partially broken, and it appears to say Ishriel instead of Israel, and so there are reasons that I think that is Israel, but this one on the Merneptah stele is the oldest definitive one. Nobody that I know of debates that it says Israel. Everybody agrees that it says Israel. But I think where this is really important is that it helps us to establish the fact that by 1208 BC, in the 13th century, Israel was already established in the land of Canaan as a people group and as a group that was the dominant group controlling Canaan at that particular time. And I think that this affirms the early date for the Exodus. So there are two major theories about the Exodus. One is an early date around 1400, 1406, maybe a little later, depending on which version or manuscript you're using. And then the 13th century. So if we want to simplify it, we would say like a 15th century Exodus or a 13th century Exodus. Those are the two dates. The problem with the Merneptah Stila for the 13th century people is I don't believe there's enough time for the right. Exodus to have happened in the 13th century, 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, at least 6 years for the conquest and establishing themselves as the dominant group there by the time Merneptah attacks and claims that this is the most important thing. So it's important because it's the earliest reference to Israel. And I think it's an important chronological marker for us that implies or would lend weight to the early Exodus theory or date of the Exodus.
Right, right. And the Bible certainly, between Joshua and Judges, gives us the idea that the conquest, it took its time, but then when Joshua told the individual tribes to go out and to conquer their cities and their locations, where God said, I will give you houses you didn't build, vineyards you didn't plant, that took time. That was not just an overnight thing. And some of them couldn't conquer, and they were just back and forth. And so to have a nation established by the end of the 13th century BC, if the Exodus took place, just 70 years or so before that, that's really cutting it close.
Yeah, it's too tight for me.
Yeah. So, okay. So our next item on the list, our number seven item is another stele. It's one that I think is fascinating. The Moabite stone or the Mishah stele. What is that?
Oh, this is a great discovery. In fact, you could probably make a movie of this particular discovery. It's amazing. And so in 1868, there was an Anglican missionary named Frederick Klein. And he heard about this black stone monument in Jordan with this inscription on it. And when he, a whole bunch of things happened, but he and others tried to purchase it and they took a squeeze of it, like a paper mache squeeze. And they had to actually take the squeeze off while it was still wet because the different tribes vying for it broke the stela and the guy who got it was racing away on a horse with this wet paper mache squeeze with him, but we're thankful he did because, the stone was broken. Another man was able to purchase much of it, but not all of it, but because we have the squeezes, we're able to have the entire inscription for the most part. And it turns out that it is a victory monument again for the Moabite king Mishah or Mesha, depending on how you want to say it. And it describes the same events as are described in 2 Kings 3. Now, it describes more than that. It's describing, again, it's probably made near the end of his reign, describing a lot of things in his reign, but it references this event that Moab had once been subject to the kings of Israel, the northern kingdom of Israel, and had rebelled. And we read that in 2 Kings 3, 4-6. It says, now, Mishah, the king of Moab, was a sheep breeder. He had to deliver to the king of Israel 100,000 lambs, and the wool of 100,000 rams. But when Ahab died, the king of Moab rebelled against the king of Israel. So King Jehoram marched out of Samaria at that time and mustered all of Israel. And then when you go to the Mesha stele, that you see this. It says, I am Mesha, son of Chemosh, that's their god, king of Moab, the Dibonite. It goes on to say, Omri was king of Israel, and he oppressed Moab for many days because Chemosh was angry with his land, and his son replaced him. And he said, I will oppress Moab, but I was victorious over him and his house, and Israel suffered everlasting destruction. And he goes on to talk about the things he did. So the Moabite stone is significant for at least three reasons. First of all, obviously, it corroborates the events described in 2 Kings chapter 3, confirms Moab was subject to Israel, that Moab rebelled, and it confirms the primary god for Moab was Chemosh, even affirms that Mishah was a sheep herder. Secondly, it contains a reference to Yahweh, something that Mishah claims to have stolen or taken were the altar hearths of Yahweh. We don't really know what those are, but important that it's a very early inscription that mentions Yahweh, the God of the Israelites. But probably the most important part in recent years is the fact that it now has been confirmed that it contains a reference to the house of David. Now, this was something that André Lemaire had proposed way back in the 1990s, but they now have done a number of different, the technology, the photographic technology has caught up to the point where they are now able to see the dots that previously one dot they didn't see that was the ending of a word. So the inscription has dots between words. And so it has pretty much been affirmed now that this says House of David, which is the second House of David inscription. So again, talking about King David and his house implies that there is a dynasty there. So the Moabite stone, hugely important for a number of reasons.
Yeah, it's a really, really cool artifact. Something that I have not seen in person, but would love to. So, all right, our next artifact we want to talk about is when kings and different administrations did their work and did all the things that they did, they like to record these things. And the Babylonians, whom we have talked about already, were no exception to this. So there's a Babylonian chronicle that talks about Nebuchadnezzar's invasion to in Judah, to Jerusalem. Can you tell us what this is and what it's about?
Yes. Yeah, so the Babylonian chronicles are a series of clay tablets that recount the history of the kings of Babylon. And they're important because oftentimes they will give not a sequential year-by-year thing like the Assyrian Lemu lists, but the major events through the reign of particular kings. One of the things that's really interesting about the Babylonian Chronicles is that scholars have noted that they tend to be very, they tend to be more objective in their recording of events than the victory monuments of other kings often are. Oftentimes, particularly in Egypt, scholars have long noted how much propaganda is really just put out there through the victory monuments. Whereas the Babylonian chronicles tend to be muted, and they tend to be just a little bit more objective. And so the Babylonian Chronicle for the year 605 to 594 BC is really important because it records the fall of Jerusalem or the siege of Jerusalem under King Nebuchadnezzar. And so hence its nickname is the Jerusalem Chronicle, but it's just one of the Babylonian Chronicles. And in this, it says in the seventh year, the month of Kislemu, the king of Akkad, that's the king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, mustered his troops, marched to the Hatti land. Remember, that's the area that includes the southern Levant area that includes Judah. He besieged the city of Judah, so that's Jerusalem, on the second day of the month of Adarunot. And he seized the city and he captured the king. And he appointed there a king of his own choice and received its heavy tribute sent to Babylon. Now, this is really important because when you read 2 Kings, particularly chapter 24, what you read is you read these exact events. The biblical version where Nebuchadnezzar comes, he lays siege to the city of Jerusalem. He takes the king Jehoiachin, takes him into exile. We read about that in 2 Kings 24, 8 to 17. And then he puts a new king on the throne, Mattaniah, who becomes the king of Judah, and he changes his name to Zedekiah. That's how we know him more often. And we're even told about the heavy tribute that is taken back to Babylon. The treasures of the temple and the treasures of the kings were told in 2 Chronicles 36, verse 18. So we have this event that's described both in the Bible and the Babylonian Chronicles, and what you see is that they both affirm each other. They both describe the same events in shocking detail, and so really, really important. Plus, it gives the date of this particular siege of Jerusalem. And now, Nebuchadnezzar came a number of times, so it can be a little confusing, right? He came, first of all, in 605 or so, 605, 604. There's some debate about a year's play either way, so 605, 604. he comes to Jerusalem, he takes some exiles. So Daniel was part of the group that went there. And then we have the city falling in, or we have this description, which is in 597 BC, March of 597 BC. And then, of course, we have the ultimate fall of Jerusalem in 587, 586 BC. So this one here is talking about the 597 one, the one where Jehoiachin is taken as taken to exile, Zedekiah, Mattaniah is put on the throne and his name is changed to Zedekiah, all described in the Bible, all described in the Babylonian Chronicles.
So what we see with these objects we've talked about today, what we are seeing is that what we read in the text and the scripture is what we're finding in the ground.
Exactly. Yeah. I've often said that the Bible is historically accurate. The phrase that I use all the time is that it describes actual people, authentic places, accurate history. That's what we see. There are some people out there who would say, well, the Bible's just a religious book, as if being a religious text and a historical text are mutually exclusive. They're not. In fact, any of the ancient inscriptions we find are religious texts. It doesn't matter whether it's Babylonian or Assyrian or Egyptian, they're all talking about their gods and accrediting their victories to their gods. So all ancient historical texts really, or the vast majority of them are religious texts as well. And so what we see is that the Bible is historically accurate. What we read in the Bible, where we find extra biblical artifacts and evidence, it tends to affirm the Bible, it tends to clarify the Bible, illuminate the Bible to help us understand better what was happening.
Yeah, and certainly these items we've looked at today have helped to do that. We're going to look at the rest of the top 10 list on the next episode of Biblically Grounded. Our guest today has been Bryan Windle. He runs BibleArchaeologyReport.com. I highly recommend you take a look. Some great resources there. Bryan, thank you for joining us today, and we look forward to hearing the rest of the top 10 list on the next episode.
Thanks so much, Clayton.